Hello, you're right. You're awake. You're alive. I'm really happy to be here, especially as a warm up to Matt Moss, who I really, really like. It's 4 a.m. More or less in New York City, so I want to let rip a little, so forgive me. Does it always take two? I don't know. Collaboration, I'm suspicious of it. Correction, I'm against it. Collaboration always sounds like Nazi-occupied France. Working in groups, is that always good? I don't know. Relational aesthetics, I'd rather have a weasel rip the flesh off my face. Doing fake politics in a gallery after reading 15 pages of Jacques Rancière, give me a break. Creative minds gravitating towards each other, it makes me want to puke. Are we all connected? No. Is everything connected? No. That's just Western Buddhist ideology masquerading as spirituality. Fuck Buddhism and fuck yoga too. I'd rather talk to a fundamentalist or a jihadist. At least they actually believe something. So, ladies and gentlemen, I have a slightly jaundiced view of collaboration. Let me try and explain why. I'm a man, and I've worked in pairs. I'm a little suspicious of men working in pairs, however nice they might be, and they can be really nice, like Fish Levice. I met them once and they were really nice. Men only seem to be able to be together by devoting themselves to some third term, the work, the project, the book, the album, the show, whatever. This is certainly my history of working in male pairs. There is something intensely and uninterestingly homoerotic about men working in pairs, and it can exclude women in all sorts of ways. Pairs of men work feverishly and persistently with each other in the service of their relation to each other, but in the service of some third term, the great project, the work, the book, the album, the show, whatever. I've worked a lot in male pairs over the years in relation to music with my friend John, in relation to words with my friend Tom. They're both nice people, lovely people, as Americans would say. I love them. And some of the work we've done, I'm really proud of, and I think it's good. But I question the mutual narcissism of working in pairs. In my case, non-sexual homoeroticism of the activity. It's finally a bit macho, despite all appearances to the contrary. Why was I always pairing with men rather than women? I asked myself this question some years ago, at which point I decided to work in a pair with my wife, Jameson. This will be the answer, I thought, a genuine collaboration based on love, not sublimated homoeroticism, but love rooted in actual sexual desire. We wrote a book together on Shakespeare's Hamlet. I think it's a brilliant book, mainly because I hear her voice and not my own, and she's a genius. It felt like an extended act of ventriloquism, my voice becoming her voice and vice versa. We were fortunate enough to publish the book with a big-time publisher in 2013. About 6 weeks after the book came out, after a series of apparent accidents, we split up. She left, and then I left. I think that work, good work, always has a price, a pound of flesh. But to be honest, I'm not sure this was worth paying that price. In fact, I'm very sure it wasn't worth paying that price. It was as if making that pairing public exhausted the privacy of our relationship. Private pairs don't always make good public pairs. So maybe you can see why I'm not the biggest fan of working in pairs. Ladies and gentlemen, I've now adopted the Greta Garbo aesthetic. I want to be alone. I want to be alone. We're alone, we live alone, we die for sure alone. Prince was alone, for God's sake. There's love, which is very nice indeed, but a pairing is alone to alone. Also importantly for me, aesthetic experience at its most intense is alone. It's the experience of something that affects you in solitude, in apartness, in isolation. I could dress this thought up with quotes from Maurice Blanchot, but it's late and that would be pretentious. So must art be measured by its relational character? No. Is the quality of art or aesthetic experience to be judged by engagement? No. Like it says on the Guggenheim Museum website, visit, art, engage. This is stupid. And the Guggenheim Museum shouldn't be stupid. I think you call this institutional critique, don't you? The world is stupid enough, God knows. Visit, art, engage is as stupid and ideological as eat, pray, love, except art seems to be being used as a verb, which is weird. To art, I art, we arted, we will have arted. Visit, yes, art, yes, engage, why? Why not disengage? Why not allow art to draw you apart from the world and speak to our solitariness, our isolation, into a kind of reverie, a state of suspension from our seemingly endless, noisy engagement with the world and with others? After all, we need a break, right? Aesthetic experience is, in a deep sense, non-relational. In contrast to the huge inflation of engagement, participation, collaboration, and practice, I want at least to raise my little voice for the contemplative, solitary, isolated, alone experience of art. Perhaps it's also this that quickens the heart. Nancy Spector, with whom I have collaborated as a pair on an event like this a few years ago, and I'm happy to say we didn't break up, asked me to talk about pairings in philosophy. Philosophy is my day job, and I promised Nancy that I would. She wrote to me, and she's right. She says, this is Nancy, there is Deleuze and Guattari, but are there others? Do Plato and Socrates count as a pair? Okay, Deleuze and Guattari, D&G, the Dolce and Gabbana of philosophy. They write, philosophy is a kind of arsefuck. This might sound offensive or absurd, but it's powerfully true. And let me explain briefly with reference to our friends, the ancient Greeks. Classical Greek education, this is the educational moment of the talk. Classical Greek education was restricted to boys, ephebs, and had a peculiar character, pederasty. It consisted in a pairing between an older man, an erastes, and a younger man, an eronymos. It was an erotic relation. The younger man received education and wisdom from the older man, and the older man received sexual pleasure from the younger man, often in the form of intercrural sex, with the erect penis of one rubbing between the thighs of the other. This is also known as the Princeton rub, or, where I'm from, the Oxford rub. Now, the Greek model, unlike the American model of higher education, incurred no heavy financial debt, but was instead an eroticized educational exchange to the benefit of both parties. Now, philosophy, philosophia, the term that Plato introduced in his dialogues, also featured a pairing, a relation between an older man, usually Socrates, and a younger man, any one of his dialogue partners, and indeed Plato himself, who was a younger man, but who remains invisible in the dialogues is mentioned only twice. The innovation that philosophy introduces into the classical pederastic pairing is that Socrates does not have sex with the young men he talks to. Now, this would have been shocking to the classical Greeks. Not having intercrural sex, Socrates? Missing out on a Princeton rub? Are you crazy, Socrates? It's okay, the Athenians killed him sometime later. Famously, in the dialogue Symposium, Alcibiades, who was really hot, a hot young aristocrat who was also very smart and later became a tyrant, declared his love for Socrates and recounts, he's drunk when he says this, he recounts his attempts to seduce Socrates, even getting Socrates to stay late at his place after a lovely dinner and forcing him to sleep on his couch. They spooned, ladies and gentlemen, they spooned, but they didn't have sex. So, what is philosophy? It's a pairing, yes, and it's a shift in the nature of the pederastic relation between older and younger men. There is education, the sophia that one must love, but no sex. Philosophy is a pairing that sublimates the sexual relation between older and younger men. And this is what Deleuze and Guattari had in mind. Philosophy is a spiritualized ass fuck, a sublimated rub. And women are not included. Women appear either as Socrates' wife, Xanthippus, who is kicked out early in Socrates' death scene in the Phaedo, as Socrates insists that she's being too emotional, or as the goddess Diotima, who teaches Socrates the true nature of love. Namely, women are either degraded as household servants or idealized as goddesses. In both cases, they're excluded from the pairing of the dialogue. And although things have changed somewhat in three millennia, this pairing is still the way philosophy proceeds in education and the spiritual rearing of young philosophical minds, which is why, in my humble view, the whole thing needs to be torn down, rethought, reimagined, and fundamentally transformed, and a lot of work remains to be done. So, you can perhaps now see why I'm a little suspicious of male pairings in philosophy and in art, and why I've decided that I want to be alone. But, and I will leave you with this thought, what is it to be alone? I can't develop this point at the moment. Never believe it when people say that. I can't develop this point at the moment. It's far too complicated. I'm still figuring it out. But we're not alone in the sense of being all own or all one. The fundamental characteristic of the self is that it is divided over against itself, between a dimension of the self that I am, my body, say, and the self that I have, what we call thinking, or what some people still persist in calling the mind, as if we know what that is. Some people call it self-consciousness. The fundamental division is caught in a lovely German expression, Ich bin, aber ich habe mich nicht. I am, but I do not have myself. In other words, the self is not centered, but eccentric. Essentially eccentric. Now, there are people, maybe some of them are in this room, I don't know, who experience no division between themselves and themselves. There are people who are not eccentric. These are people who are ontologically secure, who experience themselves as healthy and vital, body and mind, inner and outer are one. They think with their bodies, as their bodies. Perhaps they're even at one with the cosmos. Maybe this is why some people do yoga. That's fine, it's nice. But there are other people people like me and some of you who do not experience an identity in themselves and who are characterized by what we might call, following the great R.D. Lang, ontological insecurity. These are people for whom autonomy is not a fact, it's a question, a search, a cry in the darkness, a struggle even to survive. They have eccentric minds, schizoid minds, cracked minds, anxious minds, minds for whom existence is a series of questions without answers. Some of these minds go mad, splitting into two distinct and warring me's. Some of them cannot bear the absence of security and kill their hated selves in acts of self-murder or suicide, which is increasing, increasing, increasing. But there are others, let's call them sane schizoid individuals, who transform those questions about themselves into art, turn their eccentricity into work, moreover, that does not satisfy them in any way, but which at least gives them the courage to continue, to go on, to persist in their being. And these are our heroes: Shakespeare, Emily Bronte, Kafka, Beckett, Anne Carson, David Bowie, and Prince, who at one point transforms himself into a symbol, an artist formerly known as Prince. Here, the eccentric pairing, the it takes two-ness, is within us, each of us, dividing ourselves from ourselves, making those selves sometimes feel dead, feel really dead. But sometimes they feel the most beautiful thing that there is, aliveness, aliveness. And here, at whatever time it is now on a Sunday morning, we're alive and grateful to be as such, and now to listen to Matt Moss.